down to take on the Nevada Wolfpack. The tough thing, boy, they have been difficult. They have won six straight games from Nevada. As you take a look at the weather, 45 degrees, wind is calm forecast, mostly sunny, which is a very welcome relief. As we mentioned a couple of years ago, it was tough sledding, and I mean literally, in this stadium. Ed, it's going to be noisy. Nevada has had a situation, boy, they're really working to garner more fans, get people to come to the stadium. Well, they're jam-packed today, and they are here to see these guys put on a show and beat one of the better teams in the country.
Yeah, and the way this game lines up, everyone around the country would think, oh, Boise State's a lock, but not the case at all, especially as we said in the open how Nevada has been playing defensively. We'll get to see their offense first, which runs that pistol offense. They're also very good. This is going to be a tight one, Ron.
Anthony Montgomery moves forward, and the left footer will kick it off, and we're underway. Very deep on this one. It is returnable, though, and this is Sanders from a couple of yards deep in the end zone. Bounces it outside to the left, and he'll take it down at the 21-yard line. So that means we'll take a look at number three, Jeff Rowe, who received quite an ovation when the seniors were announced here this afternoon. He's a local kid from McQueen High School.
Yeah, and he runs the pistol offense. If you haven't seen it, he lines up at about 3 yards behind the center and takes a shotgun snap. And they do a lot of play action. They boot him around. He's 6'5", 225 pounds. Finally healthy, Ron. He can really get out on the edge and run.
As we go on, particularly through this first sequence, I want you to explain a little bit more about the pistol and why the name. You see, they have a first down. Boise won the toss. They deferred to the second half. Little play action. Swings it out. Incomplete. Off the fingertips of Caleb Spencer. Well, 33 points per ball game. It's 13th in the nation. 44.3 in the last five games. Two tackles who shifted from the inside. Strong tackle number 75, Charles Manu, started at guard last year. And number 61, Dominic Green, said to be the best lineman on the team. And he has played every position. Center, both guards, both tackles. Second down and 10. Takes the snap, and you see the tailback is always lined up behind him. Hubbard will go for very short yards, and it'll be third down and long as Browning made the stop. And speaking of Browning, the defense for Boise, they allowed only 79.8 yards rushing per game in the nation. That's ninth in the country. And the linebackers, Colt Brooks, 6.5 sacks. That leads the team. Corey Hall, number 25, 98 tackles. That's more than 36 than the next guy at 43. David Shields, 38 tackles, 5 for a loss. Line to make. They've got to take it out to the 32-yard line. Rowe asked Hubbard to reshift, and he put him over there for blocking purposes. Now here comes pressure, and Rowe will fight his way to the sideline. They will not get a sack, but that's Kyle King, who was holding on for dear life, and it'll be three and out for the Wolfpack.
Very good coverage by Boise State. Boise State this year with Justin Wilcox, the new defensive coordinator. Of course, Chris Peterson was elevated to head coach when Dan Hawkins went to Colorado, has gone more to zone coverage, and they've gotten much better in the defensive backfield than they have been in years past.
Zachary Whited is the punter. Marty Tadman is the deep man. High pass, they're coming after him, and it's off the side of his foot. Now, did they get a piece of it? We couldn't really tell, but that is a very, very short kick. So that brings onto the field number 5, Jared Zabransky, after only a 19-yard punt. So on the road, this is quite a favor to be handed to your offensive unit.
And Jared Zabransky, his numbers have come down the last 3 years. He was the starter 3 years ago when they had an undefeated season, lost in the bowl game to Louisville. But it's because of the emergence of Ian Johnson. And he said, I got a little caught up in my numbers. And look at his touchdown to interception ratio. He's been spectacular. And that wasn't the case earlier in his career.
First down from inside Wolfpack territory, pitches the ball back, and Johnson is going to have about 3 yards. Since 2000, the Broncos have averaged almost 42 points per ball game, the only team in the nation over 40. They're third this year at 39.6. And that offensive line of Clady, Miller, the center, Jaden Daly, Jeff Cavender, and Andrew Woodruff, they have done a terrific job. Woodruff, at 331 pounds, number 60, a sophomore out of Victoria, British Columbia. That's Rabb in motion. Straight ahead with Johnson. Big opening, has five, has close to 10. It'll be a first down for Boise. And the initial first down of the afternoon, it's a gain of 11 as Jonathan Amaya makes the stop.
And it's Cavender, the right guard, who pulled. We remember we talked yesterday to Brian Harsin, the offensive coordinator, what type of runs they wanted to do against Nevada. He said powers and isolations. That's a power play with the backside guard coming through. And Cavender did an excellent job clearing the way for Johnson.
I would imagine there were a few gasps on the sideline to the near side when he put his shoulder down and tried to run over the back. Is this pass very long? It is caught at the 2-yard line, incomplete. Couldn't hold on.
Well, when you have Legadou Nene at 6'2", 228 pounds, going one-on-one against Paul Pratt at 5'10", you might as well throw it up. Might have tried to underthrow that just a little bit more for Nene to come back and make a play, but that was good finish of the play by Pratt in the corner.
21 consecutive games for him with a reception. Second down and 10. It's Peretta who was in motion. A whistle, and they may have had two men moving at the same time.
Part of the snap, false start on the offense. Number one, 5-yard penalty.
So let's take a look at the starters on defense for Nevada. They have forced 35 turnovers this year and lead the nation in turnover margin. They have shut out their last two opponents. And to highlight the seniors on senior day, Milan, 9.5 sacks, number 91. DeMars, 41 tackles, fourth on the team. Joe Garcia, what a defensive back he's turned into. 6 interceptions. And Nick Hawthorne, 3 interceptions. He's the strong safety, number 28. You see the blitz coming right up the middle. Picked up well. Pass thrown complete. And that is Childs. And Childs will have the first down. And finally, out of bounds at around the 27. Amaya is the man who made the stop. So it's a gain of 20 yards.
Well, you've got one-on-one coverage. Childs on the outside against Pratt because Nevada came with an all-out blitz. And this is exactly what Boise State was expecting from Nevada. Tim DeRuiter, the defensive coordinator, early in the game likes to throw all of his blitzes at you to see what you can't handle, and the offensive line did an excellent job. And the one-on-one coverage, very difficult to cover for that long on the outside.
Vinny Peretta gets the snap, goes straight ahead, and is stopped after a very short gain. Hawthorne is the man who's there to make the stop as Peretta lined up in a stand-up tailback position and got the snap.
And there's head coach Chris Peterson, who took over for Dan Hawkins, was the offensive coordinator. Had to almost hire an entire staff, Ron. I think a lot of people miss. Listen, he just didn't step up and have the entire staff that Dan Hawkins had, because a lot of guys went with Coach Hawk to Colorado and had to bring in Justin Wilcox on defense, promote Harsin, and they've done a fabulous job.
For the season, 43 touchdowns, 11 field goals up inside the red zone. Right now, with a second down and 10. And little counter trade. Johnson tries to bounce it outside. That is a really nice job defensively by number 30, Joshua Mago, a sophomore out of Fallon, Nevada. He has had an outstanding year. He was an outside linebacker last year.
Well, I think this is time off right here. As the fullback gets to the outside to throw the block, Ryan Putnam, actually it's a tight end Putnam, but lined up in the backfield. Johnson just didn't look sharp on that run, Ron. He's typically better at cutting that underneath. I think he showed a little rust on that play.
So third down and long. They need to take the football all the way down inside the 10-yard line to about the 7.5. From the shotgun, pressure. Zabransky runs up into the hole. Going to take it down close to the 10-yard line. And that is Maga, who is there to make the tackle. But Zabransky, with a very good eye on what was happening with the defense, it's a heck of an effort.
Yeah, when we visited with Zabransky, it looks like on fourth down they're going to bring the kicking unit out, which I think is smart. Get points on this. If it were fourth and a couple inches maybe, but at 2, I think you kick it. But Zabransky said he's not afraid to make plays with his legs now, and that's new for him this year. He knows he's better at pulling it down.
12 straight for Anthony Montgomery, a senior out of Hanford, California. But as Ed said just a while ago, he says that potentially he thinks he can kick it from 50 yards. This is going to be a 26-yard effort, and it is a fake. And they pitch it back to the kicker, and Montgomery is not going to come close. Boy, did he get hammered.
And I don't think you needed to take a risk there, Ron. Listen, you're on the road. You had a nice drive. Get some points. And if you're Nevada on fourth and two down near the goal line, the first thing your coaches tell you before you go in is watch the fake. So
Nevada and Butler were there to just annihilate it.
Absolutely. And you can see them backing out. They read that the whole way, Ron. They weren't even rushing. That was not an 11-man rush. Nevada was ready for that. Again, I don't think you need to take that risk. Put the points on the board.
Hubbard back into the ball game at tailback. They scrimmage from deep in their own territory, but they gave up no points. And Hubbard, left side, has five, still on his feet, counted off at about seven. The ball came loose, but it was after he had hit the ground. And the official says, mark it down at the 18-yard line. Corey Hall, who was one of the captains, was there to make the tackle, number 25. Earlier this year, Ed, when we were down in Las Cruces in a ball game against New Mexico State, Hall made so many key plays, and particularly an interception early to thwart a drive by New Mexico State.
He is so good, Ron, in passing lanes. He knows how to figure out what routes are, but he also has the hands to catch it if they throw it to him.
Lippin caught a tailback. They'll fake it to him, and now a flag goes down. And either not enough men in the line of scrimmage or we had movement.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense. Number 76, 5-yard penalty, remains second down.
Well, let's take a look at Nevada's impact players. We've already seen Hubbard. Lippincott also will get a lot of runs today. He's a former safety his last three games. He's been on fire because Hubbard has been battling a bit of a knee. And we've already seen the speed of Ezra Butler on that fake field goal. Butler, a 4.5 40. He's a former defensive tackle who lost some weight to play an outside linebacker. He is so good, Ron, in that 3-4 defense, bringing pressure off the edge.
That call was just on Wadhams, the center, which is an unusual thing, unless it's a bringing the head up or down too quickly on the long snap. From the shotgun, play action. Rowe looking, he's going to run it. And for 225 pounds, he shows great mobility. Not going to have the first down. You'll see he's about 2 yards short. Corey Hall is there to make the tackle. As you look at Chris Holt. Chris Holt graduated from Nevada, 68. Got his master's degree here in 1971. And his love for the state and also for this university, very apparent.
Yeah, he coaches the quarterbacks as well. He was a quarterback here at Nevada, a very good one. And so he still works with Jeff Rowe, and it was his decision to go to this pistol offense, which is the shortened shotgun.
Third down, you see 47% on the season, which is 17th in the nation. Hubbard at tailback, but they swing him out. Pressure, and Rowe having a hold on, making sure he doesn't fumble the football, as Mike T. Williams and Andrew Browning combine on the sack. Three and out on both of these drives. Watch, as they have opened the game.
Watch how quickly Browning. Browning gets in there. Watch the quick swim move to the inside, working one-on-one with Barrett Resnick. Slaps him, gets right inside. Great one-on-one move.
Chadman is the deep man. Here's a nice high hanging spiral. Runs into his own man. A flag goes down, and the Nevada tries to pick it up. Scramble for it at the 48. Now here is going to be an interesting call. I don't see how they could call interference on Nevada, because the Boise player, and that's what Chris Alt is coming down to say.
Yeah, they were tied up.
Yeah, they were tied up and then collided with the deep man.
Fair catch, interference on the kicking team. That's a 15-yard penalty. Yeah,
if he's being blocked, I believe. I believe they got Devon Walker. But if he's being blocked into him, they're supposed to wave that off.
Well, a look at the play right there. Interference has been called. We'll take a timeout when we come back. It is Nevada nothing and Boise nothing. Boise again with great field position. What kind of psyche does Nevada have, and also everybody else in the conference? Because if Boise holds on and wins, you're talking about a big payday. After the play, going to hear more about that from Doc Munch. And the 31-yard line. Zabransky, quick pass out in the flat. It's a nice defensive play. And let's check with Dr. Punch on just what we were addressing.
Well, Ron, show me the money. Exactly how much is this worth here for Boise State? Now, the five non-BCS conferences, they will get an estimated 9% of the BCS net revenue, estimated at $9.27 million. They divide among the five conferences. Now, if you get a team in, you get an additional 9%, and that's and Boise State will get about half of that, so $3 to $5 million. If they lose today and don't make it to a BCS bowl, $750,000 for the other bowls available to the Broncos.
Hold your thought, Jerry. I want to talk some more about that. Pitch play, nice job. Johnson's going to be knocked down for a loss of 3.5 yards. So, Jerry, obviously Nevada wants to win this ball game, but there are some funds there. This conference doesn't talk a lot about funding. Some front money is put up to these teams, isn't there?
Exactly, Ron. What happened with the new agreement with the BCS and non-BCS conferences that went into effect here in 2006? All five of the other conferences that don't automatically qualify get money, whether they get a team in the BCS or not, so they can split that $9.27 million, you know, based on performance among those conferences. And the WAC last year got about $1 million and didn't get a school in the BCS.
Okay. Well, you could see Ian Johnson going to the sideline. We'll get a report on him. Pass is thrown, and it is caught by Rabb. Did he hold on? Yes. Got a foot in bounds. Now the officials are conferring with one another, and one backs up the other, so it is going to be close to the first down at around the 22-yard line.
Well, it's a senior wide receiver working with a senior quarterback. Rabb goes to make the cut and sees his quarterback in trouble and works back towards him. There's three senior wide receivers. What an excellent catch and getting his feet in bounds. But Zabransky moving around. And now you're in that tweener position, Ron, on fourth and short.
That was a gain of 12 in that last play. And with 6:03 showing on the clock, it looks as though Zabransky, well, there's going to be an official review to make sure that he did, A, have possession of the football, and B, did not step out of bounds.
It looked on those replays to me like he did.
Did what?
That he did have, good question, that he did have possession and did have his feet in bounds.
That's great control right there, the back foot. And that's in bounds, exactly right.
Yeah, he's got it. Yeah, he's got control of that ball.
All right, now, an official review, this was not a challenge, right?
Right.
Okay.
So no timeouts are on the line here. This will be a good one to see if he has control of it. Boy, I think he does. That's really a nice job by Rabb.
Yeah.
But I think this official review is helping Boise State talk about what they want to do. They brought Montgomery out for that 4th and 2 closer in the last time and ran the fake. Now you're at 4th and right at about 1. Montgomery's long is 40 yards this year, so you're within his range. Again, I think you put the points on the board.
All right. Johnson was up, had stopped visiting with the trainer on the sideline as we take one more look at it. There's Rabb. Possession is right there. And is from the other shot. You can see that his foot was in bounds. Now, on Ian Johnson, it appeared as though he was ready to come back into the football game.
After review, video validates the call. Completed catch, 4th down.
Jerry, let's check in with you. What do you have on Ian?
Yeah, good eyes, Ron. Ian was coming back in the ballgame. He's okay. They took him out in certain passing situations. If he is releasing from the backfield, they don't want him to have both arms in the air to catch a football and get a shot in those ribs. So he came out in case he needed to use the back as a receiver. But he's fine and going back in the ballgame momentarily.
Jerry, that is such a great point. How many times do you see a quarterback get the ball a little high? So 4th down, and they have just inside of a yard to pick up the first. And Denton hit behind the line of scrimmage. I don't think so.
I don't either.
And if, let's see for the spot. No, he's not going to have it.
Yeah, and again, not to harp on it, but I think you just kick the field goal there. Montgomery has done such a great job. He's made 12 straight.
Maga again.
Yeah. Well, the hole was there, and you don't have Johnson in. And I think that's a function of his health. Ian Johnson, the best running back in the conference over on the sidelines. And you have Denton, who did a great job, goes to cut back. But Mauga comes low in the cornerback is staying there, Pratt. But I think you put the points on. I think you're looking right now with your kicker, you'd have a 6-point lead instead of it being 0-0 and Nevada getting the ball back.
Well, as they stretch it out, they're not going to make it.
No.
Now, Here's the situation. If you can believe it, if you just joined a football game, this is going to be the best field position that Nevada would have had. It's Boise who's had all the great field position situations. What it is incumbent upon Nevada to do right now.
Take advantage.
Exactly. And move the football to flip this field a little bit and make Boise play with their backs to their goal line. Going to take a timeout. 5:59 left in this opening quarter. Still no score. Is the biggest little city in the world. Want to know why? For Reno, 85.2 square miles. That's how large the city is. So there are a few jackrabbits that are counted in that total as far as the population. Hubbard in the ball game at tailback. And Nevada will scrimmage from their own 22-yard line. Give it to Hubbard. That is good penetration. As boy, they could not block that Browning youngster. Linda Cohn, let's check in with you again.
Okay, Ron. Oklahoma playing Oklahoma State. Sooners needing a win to play in the Big 12 championship game against Nebraska. Alan Patrick, 65-yard touchdown run for the Sooners. His third touchdown of the year. But the Cowboys just scored on a QB keeper, so it's 20-14 Oklahoma, Ron.
Okay, so the Sooners bouncing back from adversity as far as losing a starting quarterback, losing a starting tailback, one who could have been the Heisman Trophy winner. Second down and 12 on the 2-yard loss. Screen pass to the open side of the field. Ball is loose, and it is picked up by Boise, and that's Tadman. Marty Tadman has the ball and is finally going to be tackled at around the 15-yard line.
Well, Nevada is the number one team in turnover margin, and their coaches all week have talked about what they have to do to win this game, and this is not it, Ron. Good tackle there on the outside. I believe that was Skandrick, the cornerback, who put his helmet right on the ball and cut that loose, but not much of a hit.
Third time in this first quarter, they have given Boise a great field position. Rabb is the man in motion, number one. Johnson back in the ball game. He gets the ball, and I mean, he's knocked down immediately. Good hit by Jeremy Engstrom.
Well, Boise State has been one of the best teams in the country in the first half. They've actually outscored 54 other teams in their entire game in the first half, and right now with 0 points on the board.
And I have to say this, Johnson coming to the sideline after that first down play, he's not as close to 100% as they had thought. The coach is now really looking, saying we got to use him and use him wisely. Pass caught, hit immediately at the 13-yard line is Hunter, and the senior out of Santa Cruz, California, continued to battle. 94 Clifton, Mundre Clifton, a sophomore who's out of San Diego. He was out for 6 weeks with mono, and they have him back now.
Well, and now, boy, Nevada's defense on the short field. This is the third time they've been dealing with a short field. It's been playing very well. And Ian Johnson coming back in, I would think on third and five, use him for play action pass, get Zabransky out, who's such a good runner to the right, give him a run pass option here.
Peretta is the man to the top of your screen. That's Childs in motion. Zabransky now rolls the pocket to the right. Everybody's covered. He's going to run back to the left side looking for some help. And is breaking a tackle at the 19. Throws for the end zone, and it's incomplete. Wow, how long did that play take? Peretta, I believe, wound up being the intended receiver.
Excellent job, though, again, as J.J. Milan slow to get up, favoring that right arm. He's their best pass rusher. But the coverage was sensational, Ron. And now Boise State out looking to attempt their third field goal, although one of them was a fake and went for it on fourth. I think this should be their third attempt.
Montgomery, the ball on the left hash mark. This is a 28-yard attempt. Good pass. Kick is on the way, and he's got it. So Boise finally goes on the scoreboard at the 2:59 mark. Boise 3, Nevada nothing. Let's take a break. So we are back. Boise goes on the board Actually, there was movement by the kicker, and no flag was thrown. I'm not sure it would have made a difference as far as the length. Montgomery will kick it off. And it means we'll get an opportunity to see Big Jeff Rowe again, the senior out of right here in Reno. And I asked him on the phone the other night if it was a mistake to stay here and play locally. He said, absolutely not. Best decision he could have made. As the return's going to come back to the 21 by Sanders. And that means that Jeff Rowe will come trotting out. Waiting for the offense to get a line. You see his numbers, very impressive numbers.
And a couple of nice moments before the game as folks out there. It's always such an emotional time for a family, Ron, especially a guy who stays locally and they can follow his entire career. It was a very nice moment. He got the loudest cheer. And of course, he played in high school against J.J. Milan. He went 3-0 against Milan, and Milan said, well, I didn't really like him very much until he was my quarterback.
You know, that was funny.
For the Wolfpack.
Milan was very serious. He said, I didn't like
at
him.
All.
I just didn't.
Well,
they have had 8 plays and only 15 yards to show for it. So let's see if on this series they can put something together. Straight ahead with Lippincott. And let's go down to the sideline to check in again with Dr. Jerry Punch. Jerry?
Hey, guys, you saw a moment ago Jeff Rowe has started every game he's played since 2004 here. In the last 3 years, if you go back to 2004, look at his phenomenal numbers here, the completion. And each year he's gotten better and better. And this year the total yards may not be what he had in 05 or 04, but as far as his effectiveness as a leader on the field, the coaches can't say enough about what he has done, particularly his passing efficiency rating as a quarterback.
Yeah. You know, Jerry, I couldn't help but stay with the ball game when they played Purdue here earlier this year, which was on ESPN. I enjoyed a great deal watching the youngster run the offense and how poised he was as he just throws a pass. It should have been caught by Mitchell, and Marco couldn't hold on, so they're going to have a third down. But Rowe is an interesting young fella, and he's fun to watch. Had a hamstring pull, against Hawaii,
right.
And has bounced back.
Missed 2 games, and Coach Alt and Chris Klonakis, his offensive coordinator, they put the pistol offense in 2 springs ago, and it was really a battle between Rowe and Travis Moore to see who would handle it. And Rowe just picked it up more quickly, and those numbers are staggering, how much more efficient he's gotten in this offense.
Well, he likes it, there's no question. They're going to take this out to the 32-yard line, otherwise they're going to have to punt the football right back to Boise. Here comes pressure, and throws this one out of harm's way. It's not going to be complete. McCoy was the intended receiver. Now, I talked about it was incumbent upon them to move the ball. They also need a good punt right here. They need for Whitehead to step out there and boom at about 65.
Chris Peterson, the head coach for Boise State, has been very aggressive early on. Remember, they almost blocked one earlier. I wouldn't be surprised, Ron, if they try to come after this one again. They may have seen something on film they like to attack in their protection, or that Whitehead doesn't get it off quite quickly enough.
We see the average only 27.5 yards per boot. 9-man rush for Boise. Wobbly spiral going to come down at the 36-yard line. Flag is down. 45, 50. Across midfield to the 48. I think we're going to have a block in the back. That was Tadman on the return. 39 on the boot and 13 on the return.
They're going to get Iafalo, a backup cornerback, for a block in the back. And, Ron, how many games do you see? Have we had one game this
block
year where
back.
We haven't seen a block in the back?
Well, absolutely not. It's like a trip to the store.
It's unreal.
And it's just something that has to happen.
You just have to pull off, and you have to trust that the reason a guy like Marty Tadman is back there is that he's going to be able to avoid Shannon Savore. He can avoid him. You always expect your punt returner to at least make one guy miss.
And the first guy over to talk to him, special teams coach, and he knows what he did. He doesn't need any great lecture. Folks, this is the worst starting position that Boise will have had on the afternoon. In fact, it's the first time they've snapped the ball in their own territory. They lead it 3-0, 1:15 to play opening quarter. Ian Johnson in the ballgame at tailback. And this pass locked in, and that's for the big guy, Rab. He makes the catch and has enough for the first down out at the 40-yard line. Rab, 6'2", 199. Well, college football primetime is part of Rivalry Week presented by Remington on ESPN tonight, 7:45 Eastern. Number 20, Wake, the Demon Deacons, are battling for the Atlantic Division as they take on Maryland. And, of course, that game is up in College Park. Available in high definition on ESPN HD. Two tight ends, they shift. It's Schumann to the bottom of your screen. Johnson at tailback, and he hasn't touched the ball in quite a while. Childs makes the reception, has 10 yards, takes it across midfield, and will be shoved out of the 48. So that is a gain of 12 yards on this first down play.
You know, Ron, it's a win in their end for Boise State, but there's an interesting scenario with the ACC. Because of the new rule, if Boise State finishes in the top 16 and ahead of a BCS champion, they're also in. So even with a loss today, Boise State could finish 16 or higher. Georgia Tech now playing Georgia. They're up 3-0. And it depends on what happens in that ACC championship game.
Peretta was the man in motion. Bransky steps up into the pocket. He will be sacked. They'll knock him down at around the 50-yard line. That's Jason DeMars, who was there to make the tackle, number 33, senior out of just over the mountains in Sacramento.
But going back to that ACC conversation with Maryland, not even ranked in the top 25 of the BCS, if they were to win it and Boise State lost and didn't fall below 16, then Boise State's in it. They could even get in, Ron. If Wake Forest won or if Georgia Tech were to lose to Georgia and win, there's a lot of different scenarios that, regardless of today's outcome, Boise State still has a chance.
Well, both teams heading to their respective sidelines. You can see the clock is at hundreds of a second right now, and that is the end of the first quarter. So as we take a timeout, it's Boise 3 and Nevada nothing. Let's take a break. We'll be right back. The second quarter. Beautiful sight right there. Looking at the mountains, some of the foothills just outside of Boise. Bransky juggling that snap and then throws it complete to Rab. Rab, Nune is the man who made the reception. Both of those kids are listed at 6'2", but the way they jump, they look about 6'6".
Well, they're long. You know, long arms, able to jump. And Zabransky did a good job recovering because he mishandled that snap. And Nene was open quickly, and he got the throw. You know, with the way that Boise State is using Johnson right now, which is barely at all, luckily they have a senior quarterback like Zabransky who can handle it.
Show a first down, and again, they're moving deeper inside of Nevada territory. Straight ahead with the running play, and there's not going to be very much there for Brett Denton, the senior out of Anchorage. Linda Cohn, let's check back in with you.
All righty, Ron, on ESPN, Louisville, Pittsburgh, and this update is presented by Taco Bell. It's 17 all, and Brian Brom hooks up with Mario Urrutia, and that would get him close. A couple of plays later for Louisville, Brom finishes the deal. Rolling out and then finding Gary Barnage right there. And that made it 24-17. Louisville needing a win to keep conference championship hopes alive.
Okay, Linda. Well, Ed was just talking about a veteran quarterback in Zabransky, and you saw one right there in Brom. He could be absolutely one of the best when he's healthy. Hand off to Johnson, bounces outside, has 5, has 10, and he'll be out of bounds at around the 17-yard line. Joe Garcia is the man who finally got an angle and pushed him out of bounds.
Well, this is the difference when you have Ian Johnson in the game. He's so good, Ron. He just picks up yards. He's not the fastest guy on the field, but he's constantly going forward. He does not spend a lot of time dancing around. But, boy, as much as he's getting hit and considering that he was in the hospital for 5 days, I'm starting to wonder if this young man should actually be playing today.
Well, he was very wise, very judicious in his move to get out of bounds. And then he ran into a cameraman. And I don't know if he hurt himself again. But, anyway, he was running away from harm's way and then got hit on the sideline. Play action. Zabransky rolls to the right. Here comes pressure on him, and he finally steps out of bounds quickly as DeMars is the man who forced him to go out of bounds. It was a good job by Derek Schumann, number 91, who came back to try to protect his quarterback.
And Ryan Clady, the left tackle, is in pain over on the left side of the field. He is their best offensive lineman and really a key to this running game.
In fact,
they run a lot behind him.
Edwin, when we talked to their coaching staff prior to that earlier ball game against New Mexico State that we did, they talked about the fact they not only expect him to play on the next level, but the scouts say that he could be a first-round draft choice.
Well, he started every game last year. Oh, he got his arm caught. Yep, I've done that before. You know, you just about hold on every play, Ron. You get your hands in there, and if it doesn't get away from you, and he got his fingers caught in there on Ezra Butler, and as Butler went to spin out of that, his fingers got caught. Hopefully, he didn't dislocate too many of them. I can't tell you how many times an offensive lineman through a season will dislocate fingers.
He's a communication major, and he and Ezra need to communicate better on not getting hooked up on the field.
Ezra probably said, if you don't hold me, I won't spin out of it.
Which is a nice way of saying what we should have said from the top. He was holding and got caught with his hand in the cookie jar. Quickly to the line of scrimmage and a quick out pass with two blockers in front. And this is Nune. Gets by a tackler at the 15 and then will fall down at the 13. Milan is the man who finally came down on top of him.
Boy, that was a nice job out there on that wide receiver screen because it looked like it was a lost yardage play. And Milan, who was banged up earlier, back in. And now you have to rely on Zabransky. The thing that Jared Zabransky brings you is his efficiency as a quarterback, but he can really move. They can run on the option, but I think here, again, move him out because he is so good. Flood the back of the end zone or first down and let him move if he has to.
This drive started at the 28-yard line. That's Schumann, the tight end, who moves to the bottom of your screen. And now Nune in motion. They throw to him. He cuts back over the middle, gets by one tackle. And going to be short of the first down. It will spot him down actually only a couple of feet short as Jonathan Amaya was there to make the tackle. But I'll tell you cannot have to play as much as the Nevada defense has had to play in this first half and also face critical situations on your end of the field without finally just you break.
But here's the amazing part. They've only given up 3 points.
Exactly.
But you are going to get tired.
What is the distance told? It's like body blows in the boxing.
You start to get worn out.
Yeah.
Well, especially if they can use Ian Johnson at all. And I think if Coach Peterson would have kicked the field goals earlier, I think he'd kick another one here. You'd be going up 12-0. But because he's gone for it so many times, I think he's put himself in a place, Ron, where he has to go for it now.
Fourth down, very short. Now they're coming to the line of scrimmage like they're going to snap it quickly. Johnson does not get the ball. Quarterback sneak, and he will easily have the touchdown. If you say, why are there two yellow marks? One is for soccer when it's played on this field. The more brilliant one is our yellow line.
It's funny because when I looked over at the monitor, I thought, wait, is our computer broken?
I knew that's what you were thinking. That's the reason
thank you
I
for
mentioned
clarifying.
It. Our yellow line is a lot more expensive, I can tell you that.
Yeah, it's just a can of spray paint.
Yeah.
Good movement. That's great pad level by the offensive line.
Jaden Daly, the center.
Yeah.
Good burst coming off.
Well, he's built with good pad level. He's only 5'11", and he's probably about 5'9", actually.
Quick count again. They give it to Johnson. At the 2, at the 1. Touchdown, finally. Across the way. Arms go up. Ryan Putnam, give him credit with an outstanding block. And Johnson just continued to weave his way.
Well, Jaden Daly, again, the center on the quarterback sneak, got good pad level in that time, just the same. And Johnson goes in for his 22nd touchdown, which leads the country. Boy, Daly did a masterful job on the nose guard. Matt Hines just knocked him right out of the way. And Putnam, tight end slash fullback, getting in there and blowing up the hole as well.
Yep. They sent him across, and he took his man out nicely. As Anthony Montgomery would attempt the extra point, trying to make it a 10-0 lead for Boise. And he knocks it right down the middle. So the 12:03 to play, second quarter, new score. It's been all Boise. They have had field position, and they also have had possession time. Let's take a break. See what Nevada can get going offensively. Reno, Nevada. 10 7-0, Boise on top. The locals have come out in force today, hoping that the Wolfpack can continue their successful streak. In fact, the day they gave up their first point in 8 quarters. Right now down by a field goal and touch. And whoa, what a hit. Did the ball stay, or was it recovered by Boise? Waiting for the officials. Ball goes to Boise. A turnover on the hit. Austin Smith, watch the tackle that he'll make.
That's Dwayne Sanders. Unbelievable hit.
Schleckaway is the man who made the hit.
What an excellent job by Smith. Never even had to slow down. Most of the time you tell a young man to break down, and let's hope that Dwayne Sanders is okay. He got hit right in the chest. Now Nevada, one of the best teams in the country, -2 so far on the day. You can't do that against the number 11 BCS team in the country.
They've been reversing the charges in this situation. Today they are the ones turning the football over, is what Ed's talking about. Schumann, who flipped from the top of your screen to the bottom, straight ahead with Ian Johnson, and he'll be stopped after a gain of only a couple. And let's go down to the sideline. Dr. Punch, you have the WAC commissioner with you.
Indeed I am, Ron, with Carl Benson. And Carl, what would it mean to the Western Athletic Conference if you were to have Boise State, providing they win today, go to a BCS Bowl like the Tostitas Fiesta Bowl?
Jerry, big opportunity for the WAC. Certainly financial significance, but maybe more than that, the credibility, the respect, notoriety that it would bring to the WAC and its 9-member institutions.
You're talking to the Bowl Scouts. I think the Orange Bowl is here as well. What are they telling you upstairs?
Well, obviously, Fiesta Bowl is from a geographical standpoint, would make the most sense. But, you know, I think regardless of what game it is, Boise State and its fans would travel and would be a very, very fine representative.
Ron?
Okay, Doc. Appreciate it. Well, they try to throw a middle screen, and now Blackman's down. You know, they may have gotten the linebacker, Matt Hines, who was holding on to number 41, Ian Johnson, would not let him out on that middle screen.
Yeah, you rarely see it called.
They could have called offense.
Wow. Well, a couple of the offensive
linemen. Sorry, Matt, we didn't see the hole.
Yeah.
Jerry, you're still with the commissioner. Go ahead.
Hey, Carl, no one says it's easy to be a commissioner. Now, you've got to be Switzerland here. You've got to be neutral, totally neutral on what's happening on the field. But on the other hand, if one of these teams wins, the WAC and a lot of conferences get a lot of money. How do you deal with the emotion?
Well, I think we always have to worry about what's in the best interest of the conference, and there's always going to be a team that wins and a team that loses. Fortunately, here, both teams are going to bowl games, two of our outstanding programs, and regardless of who wins or loses today, it's going to be a great day for the WAC.
Hey, congratulations on a great year.
Thank you, Jerry.
As Carl Benson, four schools going to bowl games here in the postseason.
Commissioner, thanks so much for taking time to come by. Jerry, good work there. A holding call called against Boise. Blitz is coming up here, but great protection. Man is open at the 11-yard line and unable to hold on is Jeremy Childs, the freshman out of Los Alamitos, California.
Well, Ron, now you're in a 3rd-and-18 situation. I think some type of screen or delay draw. You hate to be thinking like this, but up 10-0 in Nevada offensively, turning it over on special teams, not being able to get things going. I think you want to cut this in half and get your excellent kicker out there and try to get this lead to 13-0.
Peretta comes into the lineup. Now let's see what they do with him. Nope, they're going to put him in a slot, top of your screen. However, they've got a couple of plays for him. They scored against New Mexico State when they rolled him out. This time they come the opposite direction, and there's your Mr. Reliable right there. That's James. Dryzen, James, Nune, and Rab, all excellent targets, and they can get up and catch the football nicely.
Well, and you're going to be in another 4th-and-short situation. How many? Is this the 4th or 5th time that Chris Peterson has had to make a decision on 4th-and-short?
Well, I see a second tight end checking into the ball game.
He's going with the big body, so they're going to go for it again. The 4th and short. And I think all of these field goals are leaving out there.
Well, let's see what happens here. Zabransky looks at about half a yard to pick up the first. They go straight ahead with the carry, and the tackle is made. And I'll tell you, I don't think it may be just a couple of inches, but Mauga again is right there on the spot, and you can look at where the yellow line is and where they put it down. They're going to fail this time again.
Yeah, I don't think they got it. I really don't. What an excellent job by Margaritti. He did both of those where he read it, came over the top, and made the tackle. And if you put three field goals on the board, and I know, listen, you can say they're not automatic, but their kicker hasn't missed since his first kick of the season. This game could be at 19-0 instead of Nevada football.
Nevada holds again. Well, it's not, I said it once, I'll say it again. It's time now for the offense to step up, because the discrepancy in plays, we checked it just a moment ago, 11 snaps for Nevada and a total of 30 for Boise in this ballgame. You've got to give that defense some rest.
Right, 144 total yards for Boise State, 18 total yards for Nevada. And the senior Rowe, and let's not put it all on Rowe, he's had a couple of drops, too.
Yeah, exactly.
Everyone's got to step up their game.
That's Hubbard standing behind him, Ed, the senior out of Oakland, who's had a knee, an ulcer, an ankle, but is healthy enough to play today. If you could see a fumbled snap, they never made connections, and Boise almost on top of that one. If you look at the replay, a juggling act by Rowe, and he made his own recovery.
And this is one of the reasons that this short snap is very difficult, Ron. You know, the first time I saw this offense, I felt sorry for the center, Jimmy Wadhams, because a regular shotgun snap at 7 yards, you can really fire it back. But with the quarterback only at three, it's got to be a touch throw. It can't be speed. And Wadhams that time fired it back there, Rowe not able to hold on to it.
So with the loss on the play, they've got to take this ball out to the 24-yard line. And playing behind the sticks against this Boise defense as they come with the blitz. And he is getting away from the blitz, loses the ball, and Boise has recovered it, I believe, inside the 5-yard line. King, I thought, was on the football, number 44, and they have it. First and goal for Boise. Three turnovers in the first half against Nevada.
We got a blitz coming on the top side. They blocked inside out, so Ging, I can't even figure out why he didn't finish the play, but Rowe, as he spun out of Ging's attempted sack, went to put the ball on the ground and fumbled it away, and Ging, who realized he'd made a mistake in not making the sack,
wow,
gets lucky to finish that one.
And for people watching, when you put the ball on the ground,
it's
you're not
still
down.
A fumble, correct.
The elbow, you cannot. The ball is down at that point.
What a change of tune for Nevada. They've been the best team in the country in turnover margin, now -3 against the best team in the conference.
You see the shift. They go power to the short side of the field. They give it to Ian Johnson behind the blockers. Touchdown. They make it look easy. And I believe a timeout had been called before the ball was snapped.
Timeout. Nevada, their first charge. Team timeout.
That's interesting. The referee turned. See, Boise is asking. They said, we didn't call a timeout. The referee is signaling toward Boise. It was Nevada who called the timeout, I believe.
Yeah, he said, I believe he said Nevada.
Okay. Well, the Boise coaches are still on the field, and that's what they're asking.
No, and Frank White, the referee, just corrected that it was, in fact, Nevada.
Coach Peterson said, wait a minute. We just missed a touchdown, and we didn't call timeout. Jerry Punch, let's go back to you.
Hey, what happened here is that Barry Sachs, who's the defensive co-coordinator for Nevada, saw something when Boise lined up and sent one of his players running down the sidelines out of bounds, who grabbed the linesman and called timeout right before they snapped the football. So no one on the field saw the timeout signal. It actually happened from behind the field or off the field back here in the end zone by a player sent down by Barry Sachs, one of the defensive coaches, to get the timeout called before the snap of the ball.
Hey, Doc, do you know what he saw?
You know, he was pointing to the right side, exactly where Ian Johnson was going to run. I don't know if they were lined up wrong or didn't get the signal or what, but as soon as he saw it, he sent the guy down the sideline to get a timeout.
Doc, they didn't shift. They just stayed where they were. Right. And all of a sudden, you had two blockers against nobody.
Yeah. Well, he probably saw a misalignment by his defense he wanted to change, but what he really saw was his defense on the 4-yard line again against one of the best offenses in the country. I'd call timeout as well.
So the situation, if you just joined us, we talked about it off the top of the telecast. This defense right here has been They've had back-to-back shutouts, and this team, you know, number one in the nation. As you take one more look at what happened, here comes the blitz.
Oh, the timeout was to challenge us, but that's a fumble. As you pointed out, Ron, putting the ball on the ground is a fumble. Yep. If he'd have put his elbow and the ball had come out, then it would not be.
Yeah.
And I go back, the most famous one I've ever seen was Clint Sterner against Tennessee when Arkansas was undefeated back in the late 90s and trying to run out the clock, did the exact same thing.
So you see the fumble right there and the reason they have the ball inside the 5-yard line. But to complete what I was saying, they have led the nation in takeaways and already three fumbles, three giveaways in this opening half. Boise doesn't need any help. They are plenty good enough without sending aid.
Yeah. And Frank White, the referee, has already reported that the challenge went in the favor of Boise State, as it should have. And I don't know, looking at the replay, why Nevada would choose to challenge that, because it was obviously a fumble.
Well, let me ask you this. Did they call timeout to challenge, or the alignment? Are they being charged with two timeouts?
I don't believe they only got one.
Johnson, right side, he'll score again. Number 66, when you watch the replay out of Bishop Kelly in Boise, watch the block the number 66 throws.
There he is. Again, you're just looking at the power. This is exactly what they said they were going to do all day long. Miller comes around. It doesn't take much because the defender who's standing in the hole, Nick Furr, just goes to Barry, and you can't duck your head against a running back like Ian Johnson.
Anthony Montgomery tries to make it a 17-0 ball game. And all of a sudden, the stadium that was very, very noisy and excited has gone silent. 17-0 as Montgomery is good with the extra point attempt. And with 8:34 showing on the clock until halftime, we'll take a break. And the new numbers, Boise 17 and Nevada nothing. We'll be right back. Well, the Heart of Reno Wedding Chapel. It's been operating in Reno for 34 years, offering civil or traditional weddings, or uncivil, in one of two beautiful chapels.
I was going to say, what is a civil?
D'Angelo Wilson is the deepest man for the Wolfpack. Here's a line drive kick. Knuckleball picked up at the 6-yard line by D'Angelo. Takes it right up the middle. Here comes a flag from deep downfield. Oh, boy. So rather than having decent field position, you're going to take a long walk back. And now here comes another flag thrown in.
Yeah, there was a little chest bumping going on. You wouldn't think, if you didn't understand the stakes in today's game for Boise State, it's been Nevada who's been playing tight, not Boise State.
Holding on the receiving team, 10-yard penalty. Dead ball, personal foul, number 40. Both penalties will be assessed. First down.
Well,
yeah, post play foul, that's right. After the hold is stepped off, then it'll be half the distance.
And Chris Altsbunch just has not played well. They've looked tight. They haven't looked like themselves. They haven't been. You have 8 yards of total offense, zero first downs.
Well, the difficult
three
thing,
fumbles.
If they continue to give themselves,
yeah,
for one reason or another, right. They've been in the hole, and it's hard to make a living off a team like Boise scrimmaging from your own 9-yard line.
But it looks like Nevada's the team that's playing for everything to lose,
yeah.
Not Boise State.
So let's see what Jeff Rowe can do. Hubbard is behind him at tailback. Give it to Hubbard. They run it back into the short side of the field. Linda Cohn, let's check back in with you.
Oklahoma State making it tough for Oklahoma to clinch a berth in the Big 12 title game. Bobby Reed to DeJuan Woods was its first touchdown in six games. Cowboys now within seven, under 7 minutes to go.
Okay, Linda. Well, they call it bedlam in that series. It doesn't matter if it's basketball, if it's wrestling, if it's baseball. It's always termed as the bedlam series in the state of Oklahoma. And you can see the numbers right there. It's been bedlam here as far as Nevada and their offense. They simply have had none. second on the play clock. And they go straight ahead with the carry again. And I'm not sure he got it off. Yeah, it's going to be delay of game.
Boy.
Part of the snap, delay of game.
Nevada's got to get out of this funk.
5-yard penalty.
And let's check in down on the sideline with Jerry Punch. Jerry?
Hey, Ron, Nevada head coach Chris Hall does a great job of being very supportive in teaching his players. And during the entire last defensive possession, he spent time basically talking to Jeff Rowe, his senior quarterback, trying to calm him down. He's talking to him now, trying to calm him down, get him to relax. And really the ultimate message was, Jeff, stay in the pocket. Don't move around so much because you've got to be very careful that you're going to turn the ball over here or have problems.
Okay, Jared, right now they're scrimmaging from 4.5 yards away from their own end zone. Boise showing blitz off the corner. Here they come, and they're going to throw the middle screen. They've got it complete. Not enough for the first down, but at least a little breathing room. That's Caleb Spencer, who made the reception. And they'll mark him down at the 14.
Well, I think that Chris Ault is... got to calm his quarterback down. This is a local young man from right here in Reno playing his last game. I bet you that Jeff Rowe put a lot of pressure on himself before this game and maybe got himself a little too worked up.
The 10 yards they just picked up is the longest gain today by the Wolfpack. See if they can get a first down. They need to take it to the 19-yard line to do it. Steps up, throws the ball. That is quite a catch. After the ball was there, Caleb Spencer, and he comes around and has a word for the defensive back, Hall, actually the linebacker Hall.
Well, they were showing blitz and backed out, and Hall, who, as we know from talking to the defensive coaches and watching film, so good in the passing game, understood exactly where that curl route was going to be by Spencer. But give him a lot of credit for coming down with that as he took a shot right in the backside as he was catching it.
Initial first down of the afternoon for Nevada. Keep it on the ground. And this running play will go for about 5 yards. Here's the Aflac trivia question for today. And it is, when was the last time Boise State had an undefeated season?
It's kind of a trick question, actually.
You think?
Yeah. Well, they had an undefeated regular season in 2004, but then they went on to the Liberty Bowl. Of course, that was the year Utah went out of the Mountain West Conference to play in the Fiesta Bowl. And Boise State went and lost to Louisville.
Little option play as they move one of the wide receivers around and pitch it back to McCoy. And McCoy will have back-to-back first downs for Nevada. Now, this is what they need to do. They need to put together about 7 more of these and get on the board.
And this is the part of the pistol that you've got to have a quarterback who can move and run the option. It's a lot of the same plays, Ron. It's really not structurally, it just looks different. But a lot of the plays are very similar to what other people run. Their theory with this offense, though, is get the quarterback the ball sooner so he can carry out fakes faster.
So far, that pistol has been aimed at their own foot. Straight ahead with the running play. This is going to be about 7 yards on the carry. Gang will make the tackle on Hubbard. And all of a sudden, this offense moving the football, taking a little time off the clock, allowing that defense to get some rest as well.
Well, it's been since 1980 since Nevada has been shut out. The entire time that they've been in Division 1A, they have not been shut out. It's the longest streak in the country. And as you mentioned, this pistol better start aiming in other directions if they want to keep that streak going.
Lippincott and Hubbard in the backfield. Second down, they need about 3. Gives it to the first man through, and that's Lippincott, and they'll have on a huge opening a first down across midfield. And let's check in again with Linda Cole.
Okay, Ron, coming up in the Yamaha ATV halftime report, the Oklahoma Sooners are trying to clinch. Can they? We'll have the highlights. We had an upset in Morgantown as South Florida leaves happy, and the Gators keep streaking against Florida State. All that and more coming up at halftime of the Yamaha ATV halftime report.
Okay, Linda, thanks so much. There are many who think that was not an upset in Morgantown. That conference beginning to show they're a good conference, but they're not as great as some people have made them to be this year. little play action. Throws this one way too hard just to throw it away. The pressure coming from Ging. And you see his head coach right there. And he's hollering at the receiver to make his cut quicker or to come back to him?
Probably come back a little more. He was running more at an angle. A lot of times you want the receiver coming, it's called down the line, come right back towards your quarterback so it's an easier throw. If they're running at an angle, especially when your quarterback's on the move, it becomes a much more difficult throw.
This is the ninth play of the drive. It all started back at the 9-yard line.
They're having some disagreements over there.
Well, what's happened is when you roll that far, the sideline becomes a 12th defender anyway. They try to set a screen, and the intended receiver was tackled. That was Hubbard.
Well, and they want Kyle Ging for pass interference, Ron, but it's behind the line of scrimmage. And in college football, you can hit the receiver behind the line of scrimmage. They allow the offensive lineman to get downfield and block, and Ging very smartly came up and knocked down Hubbard, and the completely legal play.
So it's going to be third down and 10. The crowd continues to boo, and we are under 3.5 minutes to play until halftime.
Well, we haven't seen many boots yet, and that's part of this pistol offense.
Rowe is going to call timeout.
Charge timeout.
So they have one timeout remaining. He'll go to the far sideline and visit with his head coach. We'll take the break with him. Still 3:29 left until halftime. 17-0, Boise.
SAP software can grow.
So the situation, time is back in. It's third down and 10. And down 17-0. The Wolfpack needs desperately to not only pick up this first down, but to get points before we head in at halftime. Roll, straight drop. Here comes pressure, and he is going to be sacked. I mean, absolutely did not have time to take a breath. The third time that they've gotten to him today, and Brooks and Ging combining on the stop.
Well, Justin Wilcox, the defensive coordinator, has called more blitzes than I've seen them run all season. This time he brings Skandrick and the outside linebacker to the outside, and Colt Brooks, the outside linebacker, from the other side. And even though Rowe can avoid Skandrick, he cannot avoid the other two outside linebackers coming. Good call by Wilcox.
Tadman is the deep man, and here's the boot. This one's not going to turn over. No fair catch is called for. 12-yard line. Now here comes a deep flag in. Tadman still dancing around as he crosses the 20 down at the 23. 38 on the punt, 11 on the return.
And Chris Peterson calls. He's got a couple of nicknames for Marty. Used to call him the lawn boy because he said he didn't look like a football player. Looked like the guy who'd come cut your lawn.
Holding on the return team, number 11. 10 yards from the spot of foul. First down.
And then he started calling him Jimmy Neutron because not only is he a very smart guy, but he also wears his hair like the cartoon character Neutron. So Coach Peterson liked to have a little fun with his players.
Well, it's kind of wetted down right now because of perspiration, so you can't tell.
But they say he's the best pure athlete on the team. They said, you want to play ping pong, golf, whatever, he'll beat you.
Yeah. One of those natural athletes and a natural competitor. First down, one of the worst field positions that Boise has scrimmaged with today as they take it from just inside their own 10. Wanted to go long, pumped it, now throws back, has it complete. Nune. And last undefeated Bronco team was in 1958 to answer today's Aflac trivia question. 1958, when Boise won a junior college national title under Lyle Smith. They had a record of 10-0.
See, I told you it was a trick question because it wasn't Boise State that
went
undefeated.
But as we ate chicken last night, we saw the question. That pass thrown complete in the flat, and that's the tight end Ryan Putnam who threw that paving block on the touchdown just a while ago.
And I tell you, it was a very difficult schedule that year. Old Carbon College, that was a rough outfit in 1958. They shut them out. Look at all of the shutouts, Ron.
Woo. Not only the shutout, look, Dixie Junior College, they scored 75. Dixie up there just above the four corners area.
It looks like a made-up schedule when you look at it, doesn't it?
I'm not going there. About to have 1.5 minutes to play in this opening half. And if you're Chris Ault at halftime, what do you go in and talk to your offense about?
Settle down. I don't think there's any adjustments they need to make. You just can't turn the ball over that much, and your senior quarterback's just been playing tight.
Well, there is an incomplete pass as Rab got turned completely around. And Garcia looked back at the official as if to say, did you see the push off? In fact, he's turning around to him right now saying he pushed off. Well, the ball was not close enough to catch, so neither here nor there.
Well, and Boise State's going for it, Ron, and I don't blame him. 17-0 with as much that is on the line. I wouldn't be comfortable with this either, and if I had three timeouts, I think this is the right deal. Let your senior quarterback try to go down and score.
Plenty of time on the play clock. Zabransky, near side, has the ball complete, and then getting out of bounds is James.
Well, they ran the clock because James' forward progress had stopped. He shouldn't have danced on the sidelines. He should have just gotten out of bounds. Now they get the timeout late because I don't think that Coach Peterson realized that the clock had continued to run.
So we'll take a break. 1:04 left until halftime. Boise 17-0. Looking for more. So we are back. It's a third down for Boise, and they need to go to the 46-yard line to get the first down. Nevada shows blitz. They come off the top of your screen, and the play has stopped. Flag way across the field.
Well, they had to get Daly for snap, maybe snapping his head up.
You know, earlier they got Wadhams.
Yeah, for this.
I would assume the same thing.
Yeah. Sometimes you'll flinch your snap hand. If you
centers are always looking for an edge, Ed, even when it's easy.
You know, sometimes if a nose guard was really tight, I'd squeeze my hand hard because I knew he was watching the ball, so he'd jump off sides.
Oh, no. Make those veins pop up.
Guy Morris, who's now the head coach at Baylor, was an offensive line coach for us with the Arizona Cardinals, and a 15-year center in the NFL taught me that trick.
Yeah, we got an issue with the clock. It did show 4.3. Obviously, that's not right. 1 minute and 4 seconds now is what they have run it down to. And that's going to be the correct time that is left, 64 seconds. So once again, it's third down. Zabransky runs up into the pocket. Boy, this offensive line does a good job for him. Steps back, throws it complete, and that's Nune. And pushed out of bounds at the 49-yard line. So they're certainly out of field goal range here.
Well, this wide receiver group does such a great job when Zabransky scrambles.
They're smart in helping him, aren't they?
Well, they've just been working together for so long, it's so natural to them that when they see Zabransky on the move, they know where they should show up so that he sees them and get a little better field position and try to pin them down.
First punt, Ed. And we have 55 seconds left in the first half. Stringer is the man who will punt it away. Hit at the four, go into the end zone. So on ABC tonight at 8 Eastern, it's the greatest intersectional rivalry in college football when Pete Carroll's number 3 SC Trojans face off against Charlie Weiss and the number 6 Fighting Irish, with the winner staying alive in the hunt for a berth in the BCS championship game. Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines, is all a part of Rivalry Week, presented by Remington.
Well, then you take a look at the BCS top 6, USC with Notre Dame and then UCLA. The lead that Michigan has on them in the BCS is so small. If USC wins both those games, they will definitely leapfrog them.
Jeff Rowe, draw play. And Hubbard's going to be stopped after a short gain, maybe 3. Schleckaway is the guy who comes over to make the tackle.
Well, and Chris Ault.
They get a player down it. And Wadhams, the center.
And you don't want to lose your center in this offense. I described earlier how difficult a snap that is. It's a tweener between the shotgun and a... Oh, rolled his ankle.
Yeah.
Oh, just as he went to stop. What a shame. Wadhams, a former walk-on senior day. He's been a 3-year starter. You'd hate to see his season end just because he went to stop wrong.
Maybe only... tweaked it there, but the coaches just said pure and simple he's really blossomed this year. He's turned into a good ball player.
Well, I think Chris Ault and his staff are, I think they just want to get to the locker room, Ron. Things could not have gone worse for them. 3 turnovers. They were holding in there at the beginning, but then those 3 turnovers just have really hurt them.
Kyle Robertson out of Danville, California, a junior who plays center and also guard, comes into the lineup replacing Wadhams. And that will be the end of the first half as he'll let the clock run down. And let's go down to the sideline. Jerry Punch with head coach Chris Ault.
Coach, a tough first half. What do you have to do to get untracked offensively in the second half?
Well, I mean, our offensive front, you know, we're getting beat up front, and Jeff's made some critical mistakes with the ball. And, you know, you just can't do that and give it to a team like Boise. Field position has killed us. We've got to settle in there. We started to move the ball that last series. We've got to make some plays, and we've got to block that blitz coming off the corner.
Down 17 at halftime. What do you say to your kids in the locker room? An unusual place for you at home.
Well, you got 30 minutes to find a way to get this Mackey magic working.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Ron?
Okay, thanks, Jerry. Our score at halftime, 17-0, Boise. Now to Linda Cohn for the Yamaha ATV Halftime Report. Linda? The third quarter, 17-0, Boise, the heavily favored ball club in this one. Actually not. Only a 3-point edge is what the odds makers said. They thought it would be close, but I don't think anybody thought that, hey, Nevada would turn it over as much as they have. And for Jeff Rowe, it's been total frustration.
Yeah, this is the best turnover margin team in the country coming in, plus 15. 3 turnovers so far, and Jeff Rowe has not played well. The senior local product from right here in Reno has had trouble hanging on to the ball. Got a short snap there that he couldn't handle, and then as he tried to scramble out, fumbled. And Chris Ault, his head coach and quarterback coach, they've been going at it a little bit. Coach Ault just trying to get him to settle in.
Well, now here's today's Remington first half stats.
Well, it just hasn't been very good for Nevada. And for Boise State, where they're sitting right now, the story has been Ian Johnson and his health. Ron, I think both you and I agree. Sitting here at 17-0, they've been in total command. Their defense is playing great. I think it's time for number 41 to come out of the game. I just don't think you want him to get hurt again with his ribs.
Jeff rolled the numbers on him, 3 of 8, 25 yards. And I agree, you know, we talked about that at halftime. The sun is about to start going down. It's going to get very nippy in this stadium. Little north breeze coming in, picking up to about 10 to 12 miles an hour, and temperature into the 20s. If I've got a 17-point lead, or if I add to it, I think I'd put a nice warm-up jacket on him and let him stand on the sideline.
And get him ready if you win for the Fiesta Bowl against the winner of Oklahoma-Nebraska, most likely in the Big 12 championship.
So Jekyll prepares to kick it off for the Wolfpack. Jones, one of the deep men, along with Rashawn Scott. This one's going to be out of the back of the end zone, and let's go down and check in with Jerry Punch.
Guys, at halftime, talk to Boise State head coach Chris Peterson. Number one question, will we see Ian Johnson in the second half? He said, absolutely. We're not going to do anything conservative here today. He said he will play in the second half. We feel this game is far from being over. I asked him about the gambler's mentality, the fourth and short going for it. He said, that's my biggest frustration in the first half. I said, you mean going for it? He said, no, the fact we didn't make it. He said, I'm going to go for it the entire second half. He said, we're not going to be conservative at all today, but we hope to make it in the second half. Guys?
Jerry, that conservative is not the answer I'm looking for. Smart is the answer I'm looking for. So here's Johnson to carry it on first down to open the second half, and he'll weave his way out across the 26-yard line. It's about where his average is every time he touches it.
I'd like to bring Doc back in and ask him, you know, Doc, you were explaining how the barrels are or the ribs are like a barrel. Explain what may happen on the bottom of the pile or something if something goes on in this ball game for Ian Johnson.
Well, although he is padded where he has broken the ribs on the left side, the left seventh and eighth, if he gets hit on the opposite side or in the front, because the ribs are one continuous circle, it can still break at the weak point.
Okay, that's Johnson. Continue, Doctor. Tell us, exactly what the risk is.
Yeah. Well, what happens is now, when he broke the rib back in September, he broke the left seventh and eighth. Now, they had scar tissue there and some calcium that formed around the fracture site. He broke it again, or actually had the scar tissue rupture the lung 2 weeks ago. It's only had 2 weeks to heal, although he is wearing a flak jacket, and the doctors feel pretty comfortable. You see the flak jacket under his shirt there, under his jersey there. The concern would be still getting another lick directly on the opposite side and they're reopening the fracture.
Okay, Jerry. Great stuff as Johnson gets the carry. Jerry mentioned us back in the first half. He said, yeah, it is a tough situation to come back this quickly, because when you consider just a week ago, the young man had a tube the size of a water hose, in his lung, yeah, to help him make sure that he...
Well, and the other thing that concerns me, Ron, is the pylon. You know, Dr. Punch talking about getting hit on the other side because it's like a barrel and it could shift and re-break. But what if a 300-pounder or a couple of 300-pounders land on top of him? I would assume the same thing could happen.
Well, he's going to get the ball again. He'll be the workhorse and taking it close to the first down. And now with that second effort, he's going to have it down around the 46-yard line. So, Ian, as you look at his parents, Colleen and Sterling, they're fortunate. They're still on the sun side over there.
I saw those sunglasses and thought, wow, we haven't needed those all day, have we, Edward?
San Dimas, California. And he, as a freshman last year, had to share some time, but the coaches knew, even the three senior running backs, that he was going to be awfully good when they made him their feature back.
Zabransky, little play action, and in near sideline, gets that one complete to Lau. And the fullback, who does not touch the ball a great deal, has about 9.5 yards in the play. Joe Garcia is over to make the tackle.
Well, Ian Johnson was a Doak Walker semifinalist. He didn't make it into the final round, but when you stack up Ian Johnson's numbers against Slayton, Hart, and McFadden, who are the finalists, he does very well. I think a lot of that has to do with name of the school, etc. But this young man, just a sophomore, so he's going to have plenty of time for national recognition.
Denton checks into the ball game at tailback. He's about 8 yards behind the quarterback. Gets the handoff and goes for maybe one.
They're losing the trenches. You know, all over our quarterback.
Carry by number 35, Brett Denton.
Denton was the young man who filled in for Ian Johnson last week against Utah State. Had a great game. 125 yards rushing, 2 touchdowns.
Denton comes to the sideline as they'll do a little bit more by committee. Johnson, as you can see, back out on the field of play. And he wants to play every down. Schumann in motion. Blitz comes off the corner. Gravansky steps up, now throws the ball, and with the cushion has all kind of space. Nune is there to make the reception at the 18-yard line. Good job on the offensive line.
Well, the offensive line is the whole reason that this play works out, because Nune finds himself in one-on-one coverage out there against D'Angelo Wilson, spins him around, but if the blitz hadn't been picked up, and Zabransky even double clutches on this, That's how much time he was given. Good job by the fullback Lau as well, who picked up an outside blitzer.
So first and 10, didn't take very long to get inside the 20-yard line for Boise. Grab in motion. Johnson breaks one tackle, still fighting. And low center of gravity. Now he can give you a pretty good tug even going backwards. And they'll spot him at around the 12 and a half yard line.
Well, Johnson, earlier in the year, we did a Boise State game and we were talking about what type of runs he likes. And he said, you know, I think I have the speed to get to the outside, but I feel so much better between the tackles. He's such a physical runner who has such good vision. And that's where he picks up his yardage, is in the middle line. You hear so many running backs say they want to bounce it to the outside, but that's the exact opposite of what 41 likes to do.
Here he gets the handoff again and fights his way all the way down to the 5-yard line, just taking the pile with him. Ezra Butler is the man at the bottom of the pile. Brad Lau, a senior out of Boise, is the man who provided a paving block.
And last year, Ian Johnson had to share time. There were three seniors on the roster. And, of course, the Boise State coach is very loyal to men who stick through the program. So he shared time. And what's amazing is with his number of rushes going up, how much his yards per carry have gone up. A full yard. To me, that's the most impressive stat, Ron, is his productivity going up with more carries that he gets.
Vinny Peretta, number 19, checks into the ball game at tailback. Is up on the left side, and it's Peretta who gets the ball, took the direct snap, and he'll take it in to score.
Who does he think he is, Darren McFadden?
I'm telling you, how many teams in this country have we seen that are, and nothing is unique, is
yeah.
it?
Why not do this? Because the defense is trying to outnumber you. They're trying to put more people around the line of scrimmage than you can block. So if you walk your quarterback out and you have an athlete like Peretta or like Arkansas has with McFadden, why not get that out there? Now you have one extra blocker to match up against the defense. It's a nice wrinkle.
Montgomery with the extra point attempt, he's got it. And folks, listen to this. 4 minutes and 47 seconds what they took up. But here's the number that you have to concentrate on. 80 yards in 10 plays. That is an average of 8 per try. Doesn't take you long to get in the end zone that way. West, you look back at the foothills and some of the mountains over in the eastern side of the city. It's D'Angelo Wilson is the deep man. Sanders injured on that kickoff return back in the second quarter. We've been efforting to get a report on him, but they've not been able to locate him on the sidelines. Not sure if Sanders came back out to start the second half. Let's go down to Doc Punch as a flag has been thrown and a little pushing and shoving as the play went into the sideline.
And they definitely get the continuation of the play. And if I'm not mistaken,
it's a second. Foul.
Yeah, I was just going to say
receiving
that.
Team. After this is to the goal, number 40, first down.
Yeah, Zach Shapiro, that's his second personal foul on the day.
And the point of the matter is, boy, you can't be selfish in a situation like this.
Oh, wow.
You know what? Is that not a punch that he threw?
Wow, Shapiro's going to get himself thrown off the team if he's not careful.
Well, maybe he should. Can't act like that. It sure looked like a punch to be through at the bottom of the pile also. Hubbard, short yardage on the carry. Corey Hall defensively making the stop.
Things are still going on.
You know what?
On that Nevada sideline.
He has been sent to the locker room. They had a policeman going out with him.
Well, when you've got a young man who's absolutely losing control, just get him off the field. Just you can't have him around. Things are bad enough as they are. Just send the young man home.
Yeah, they had a policeman to escort him. We don't know if that is coach's decision or if it was the official's decision. This is live. As he is being sent to the locker room, and there's a policeman right there behind him to make sure that nothing else happens.
And that's Zach Shapiro, who will not be calmed down, and I bet you that's a decision by Chris Ault. Yeah, you've just got to get him out of there. Just send the young man home.
Wow. Well, you hate to see something like that, fighting with your own teammates. You got enough on your hands fighting Boise.
Well, they're losing that fight.
Well, they're losing the other one, too. Well, they're going to call it. Schleckaway is the man who came in and put the pressure on Rowe and made the tackle. And then Jeff with the decision that he all of a sudden throws the ball to make sure he's not sacked, which they left. So that's the fourth time that they have sacked him. So it's fourth down. And they'll have to kick it away. Tadman, the deep man. And Whited is standing about 2 yards deep in his own end zone. Here's the boot, his best one of the night. Wobbly high spiral. All the way back to the 40-yard line. And he is going to be tackled after a return of maybe 3 yards. And here's the melee on the sideline. And then 24-0. Boise on top. That's a look at Legacy Hall, $4.5 million facility that houses the University of Nevada Reno Hall of Fame at the lower level, where inductees are on permanent display. Chris Ault is there. He was inducted in 1993. And Johnson will get about 5 yards.
Well, this is, listen, I know Ian Johnson wants to play. He's a very tough young man, and he fought so hard to get back. But at 24-0, I hope this is the last time we're going to have to see him jog off the field. There's too much ahead for Boise State. Looks like they're in position to win this game and get into the BCS, most likely the Fiesta against the Big 12 champion between Oklahoma and Nebraska. And I know the young man wants to play, but be a little wiser deciding that.
Grab in motion, straight ahead the ball carry Denton, and he is going to be shoved back. Will have a gain of a couple of yards, then got pushed back. Jason DeMars, one of the men leading the defense.
Well, Ian Johnson is so effective. He talks about how he likes to be in between the tackles. So that's exactly what Brian Harsin, the offensive coordinator, calls. They run a lot of isolations where the fullback leads up on the linebacker on the strong side, or they run that power where the backside guard pulls and leads up. Not a lot of zone, not a lot of outside stretch plays. Call what your running backs like to run, and when a guy like Johnson gets going, he's awfully good in the middle.
That's Ian coming in motion, and he used as a decoy that time, and a pass right over the middle to Schumer. And they're not booing, that's for Schumer, and he'll have the first down. And so take it down around the 45-yard line. DeMars again with the stop. DeMars very physical, very emotional. But that has been one of the things that's been missing, although this defense has had to play just a great deal, particularly in that first half.
Well, turnovers will do that to you every time. Minus three today in turnovers has given Boise State excellent field position.
34 of the 50 on the Nevada side of the field. Touchdown, Nune. Garcia trying to cover, but Legadu had a leg up on him, and he scores the easy touchdown. As again, the offensive line they make it easy for Zabransky to stand there and go through his rotation as far as the receivers.
Well, and again, he finds what he likes on the outside. The safety was so late. The safety just hung inside. It's so easy to say that Joe Garcia got beat to the inside, but the safety, Jonathan Amaya, is supposed to be there, but Amaya came down low. Garcia had no help over the top.
Montgomery with the extra point. He's got it. So with 6:18 left in the third quarter, our new score, Boise 31 and Nevada nothing. On top here. Still over 6 minutes to play third quarter. And on ABC tonight, 8 o'clock Eastern. Boy, this is a really good one. It seems to be every time they get together. Number 6, Notre Dame coming to the Coliseum to take on number 3, SC. That is at 8 o'clock Eastern time. And Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines, all a part of Rivalry Week. And that is presented by Remington. And, of course, that game is in HD. 31-0 with the 6:18 left to play third quarter. And Wilson's going to return it 2 yards deep. 25, it'll make it out to the 28. And let's check over on the sideline. Dr. Jerry Punch, you've got more with the return man Sanders and his injury.
Exactly, Ron. Not good news. Dwayne Sanders, the redshirt freshman, sustained a pretty significant concussion in the first half. That tackle right there, that horrific tackle on the return, has produced a concussion. He is done for the day, and they were evaluating him in the locker room. He's awake and alert, but has a pretty significant concussion, as you might expect from that hit.
Well, Jerry, we could see in the replay him grabbing his face mask after the concussion of not only the hit, but his head hitting the turf. And they roll the pocket, roll it forever, and then throw it out of bounds. And that's Schleckaway. We've called his name a lot today. He has really done a good job of keeping pressure on the quarterback.
You know, one of the best hires that Chris Peterson made when he got the head coaching job was Justin Wilcox. Justin was a defensive back at Oregon when Chris Peterson was the wide receivers coach. So he's known him since Justin's playing days. And Justin, now the first-year defensive coordinator, has just done a masterful job. This is by far the best defense in the Western Athletic Conference, and it's all because of the change of structure that Wilcox brought in the defensive secondary.
Well, the quick pass, tried to get the block, nothing there. And I mean, the tackle made immediately on Spencer by Colt Brooks. Colt, a senior out of Boise. He's a former walk-on. And now the coaches talk in terms of playmaker.
Mm-hmm. They've got a bunch of them. Corey Hall, senior middle linebacker, I think will end up being the conference's defensive player of the year. And Brooks, they call Slash because he can blitz, he can cover, he can play the run, he can do it all from that outside linebacker spot.
So third down and short. They're going to throw, going to put it on top. And I'm not sure that Spencer ever really saw the ball. The coverage was very good on him.
That's Quinton Jones, a former running back.
Mm-hmm, out of Cerritos.
Switched over to cornerback. And the key switch this year for Wilcox on this defense was Boise State was almost always man-to-man. And he's gone to almost exclusively zone coverage, and it's allowed for a lot more interceptions. The fourth in the country, 17 coming into today.
Well, here's the punt, and this is the best punt of the afternoon. They needed this one way back in the first quarter. All the way to the 20-yard line is Tadman. And Tadman's going to be stopped after a return of about 4.5. Well, here's a flashback. Let's look back to January the 1st, 2005. Utah's Alex Smith dominated the Fiesta Bowl that year, completing 29 of 37 passes for them to touchdowns. Smith and Paris Warren shared the offensive MVP scoring award in the third. Paris Warren scored on a 23-yard touchdown pass with Alex Smith, and then an 18-yard pass which capped the 94-yard drive. 35-7, Utah winning over Pittsburgh.
And I think that Boise State learned a lot from that year, Ron, because at the end of the year, it was Utah and Boise State battling to see who may be the first, and Boise State got a couple too many close games, and I think all the seniors remember that well, and they're not letting it happen this year.
Ian Johnson will try to sweep it to the right side. Take a look at the BCS. Charles Wilson on that last tackle. Ohio State and Michigan. SC still to play tonight against number 5 Notre Dame. Having, of course, 8 o'clock on ABC. Florida has won. Louisville 9-1, I should say, at Pittsburgh. They are winning big. West Virginia was upset today at home. Second down at about 5. pass over the middle. Safety valve to Lau, the fullback. Ball came out, and Nevada thought they had recovered a fumble, but it's an incompletion, and that'll stop the clock. 3:55 to play in the third is Mundrake Clipton, a sophomore out of San Diego, is there to make the tackle.
And the thing to remember about why Boise State goes if they're in the top 12, because they changed the rule. Used to be an automatic bid for non-BCS if you're in the top six, but because of the addition of the championship game, two more at-large, they've opened it up for to hopefully better include non-BCS schools in the BCS bowl games.
Third down, line to make is out to the 34 for Boise. Right now, that I would think they just want to run some clock, but they're going to throw a long pass, have it complete to James. Dryston with a good second effort. And the senior out of Phoenix finally stopped by Scott Garrison, but he'll pick up 26 yards on the play. Moments ago, Ian Johnson on the
side calf. Mm-hmm. Well, he hadn't practiced barely at all.
Well, he also had not been hit, which you talked about off the top of the telecast.
Laid in a hospital bed for 5 days.
89 yards for him today. Average below what he normally has, which is over 6.5. And he will move his way to around the 49. And let's go down to the sideline. Dr. Punch, you have more on the BCS rules.
Yeah, Ron, Ed was talking about the fact that if you're in the top 16 this year and you're ranked higher in the BCS, that conference champion that automatically qualifies, you will get in. Now, if this rule would have been in effect a year ago, TCU, who was ranked in the top 16, would have played in a BCS bowl. In fact, if you go back to 1998, if that rule would have been in effect back then, we would have had six different non-BCS teams playing the game.
Thrown with an interception, and he's going to take it into the end zone. And Nevada, with another takeaway, is on the board with 2:52 to play. Yards on the return.
Well, Hawthorne just read it the whole way, Ron. What an excellent job by the strong safety. And you've got to, if you want to try to get back in this game, 2:52 left in the third quarter, you're going to have to start taking chances like that. He just absolutely jumped on that wide receiver screen and guessed right.
Interesting, his coaches are visiting with them on the phone just the other day. The comment that they made about him is he plays so much better than by the numbers. In other words, don't look at his speed and all these other things. His vertical, you know, he's just a smart football player.
Yeah, and he read that all the way. He'd seen that in film study this week, and they drilled him. See that formation, go ahead and jump it.
And the extra point attempt is up and good, and the streak lives. 316 straight games that they have scored points in. So we'll see if that stops a few of the folks that were headed for the exit. Some of the Nevada fans growing a little frustrated over the way things were going. Tonight, 7:45 Eastern Time, it's the Demon Deacons of Wake Forest taking on the Terps of Maryland. And, of course, the winner of that one is going to win the Atlantic Division of the Atlantic Coast Conference. That's 7:45 Eastern Time as you take a look on the near sideline at Hawthorne.
Well, and if Jim Grobe is at the hotel and watching, he's very happy for Nevada because Tim DeRuiter, the defensive coordinator for Nevada, played for Jim Grobe at Air Force and then was his defensive coordinator at Ohio. And for Wake Forest, they need to bounce back, Ron, after the tough loss last weekend against Virginia Tech. They were on such a roll, but they're still in it. The winner from tonight's game, because of Boston College's loss on Thanksgiving night to Miami, tonight's winner goes to play Georgia Tech in the ACC championship game.
So again, it's Jekyll who will kick it off. His last kick was out of the back of the end zone. This one is going to hit. Oh, it hit on the field of play. So a penalty. They will snap the ball from the 35-yard line.
On number 13, by rule of the ball, replaced on the 35-yard line.
And let's go back down to the sideline. Dr. Jerry Punch.
Ron, you can't say enough about what Chris Alt has done for this program. He is definitely the leader of the pack. You know, he is the only Division I active coach currently in the College Football Hall of Fame. He's the winningest coach in school history, 185 wins, fifth winningest active coach in all of college football. The guys in front of him, by the way, are Bowden, Paterno, Beamer, and Trussell. Eight conference championships and the six-time conference coach of the year, including last year when he won it as they were co-champions of the WAC a year ago. He has given so much to this school over 22 years.
Yeah, Jerry, thanks. That's, you know, I alluded back in the first half about, you know, when he got his undergraduate and his master's degree, and he loves his state and he loves the university, and he really has given himself to it. Here's Johnson, has 5, has 10, 15, counted off at 20 yards. Maybe around 19, he'll step out at the 46. Hawthorne is the man who pushes him out of bounds.
Well, talking to Chris Alt, he used to be the coach and the athletic director, and we asked him about this dual role, the former quarterback here at Nevada, and he said, well, I don't think I realized the first time I did it that I actually had two jobs. I just worked so hard, he said. When he was asked by the school president if he wanted to coach again, he decided, I'm going to have to give up the AD. I just can't do both of them. Too much work.
A lot of building going on around Nevada, around the athletic complex, the football stadium that we're looking at today, the basketball arena, and a lot of other things. That Hall of Fame that we saw on the billboards just a while ago. Moggett comes in to make the tackle on Ian Johnson on that play, and he's going to be just short of a 4-yard gain. 112 yards today, his 8th 100-yard plus game this season. 2 touchdowns for him. You see that average moving up as something Boise likes to do, and that's come to the line of scrimmage and take a quick snap. And he fumbled the snap, and the defenders came piling in on top of him.
Daly and Jabransky getting into it a little bit. Daly, the center, may not have gotten that ball up because of the quick snap.
Well, I think that's a tough transition that you, you go shotgun, shotgun, shotgun,
and
then all of a
jump
sudden
up underneath.
After 35 snaps, they jump underneath, and so, you know, you short arm it, so to speak.
Or you think it's shotgun and you go to throw the shotgun instead of snapping it up to your backside.
That could be real dangerous. Third down, they need about 10 and a half yards. Going to have to get rid of this one. Does not. Going to be sacked. That's Ezra Butler. Second time that they have gotten to Jabransky today.
I want you to watch what Butler does as he goes to sack Jabransky. Right as he goes to finish this, watch how he goes to try to strip this ball out with his right hand as Jabransky is going down. What an excellent heads-up play. Listen, you're down 31-7. And you need your playmakers like Butler to make plays. I like how he tried to finish that and not only get the sack, but cause the fumble.
He's running for a trainer. He may have hurt himself on that last play. Barely got that punt away. No fair catch. Return from the 16-yard line is Garcia. Joe's going to take it out to the 31. So 39 on the kick and 16 on the return, and we have just under 17 seconds to play in the third quarter.
Well, and Butler is definitely hurt, Ron. You're absolutely right, as we showed him over the sideline. And that's it. Looks like he's favoring the right arm, which was the arm that he tried to rip the ball out of Zabransky's hands with.
He finally takes a seat, but the trainers are going to chase him down, and he does need looking after. This probably is going to be the last play of the third quarter. Straight ahead with the running play, Hubbard to the 50, inside the 45, and Orlando Skendrick will make the tackle, and that'll be the final play of the third quarter. 27 yards. That's the longest running play, maybe the longest play of the afternoon for Nevada. So that is the end of the third quarter. We'll take a break when we come back. 15 minutes away. That is what Boise has to become the second BCS Bowl participant. So 31-7 Boise as we start the fourth and final quarter. And you look at the painted inn on the side of the mountains, a tradition that has gone on for a long time out here in the western states, BYU, Arizona State. This time the running play goes for about three. And let's check down on the sideline with an update on Butler and his injury. Once again, Dr. Punch.
Hey, Ron, good news. The trainers over here, Mark Paul and Dr. Jim Pappas, have examined Ezra and determined it was just a real significant contusion of the forearm on his right arm. They put a compression sleeve on it when he was trying to rip the ball out and fell him off. So he should be able to go back in. A little bit of tingling down the forearm, but he should go back in momentarily on the next defensive possession.
Okay. Yep, Doc, I think with the intensity of that young man, I think you'd have to tackle him to keep him off the field. Rowe sacked again. Andrew Browning. Andrew, the senior out of Lake Oswego, has really had a nice afternoon. Four times they have sacked the quarterback, Jeff Rowe.
Well, and the domination in this series continues, Ron. They've lost five in a row to Boise State. Combined score of 256-52. And in last year's ball game, Boise State sacked Nevada quarterbacks, including Jeff Rowe, seven times. So it's just been domination lately in this series.
Third down. Boise showing blitz at the line of scrimmage off the corners. And here they come. This is the kitchen sink. Spencer. A quick screen over the middle. And that went for nothing. Maybe a couple of yards. Colt Brooks on the stop. And here's what my partner was talking about.
Well, it's interesting. We talked to Chris Ault, and you had mentioned at the top of the broadcast that this was quite a, in the early 90s, quite a rivalry.
Yeah, but it's Big West.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. They kind of bounced from conference to conference, but now they've settled both in the WAC, and it's just not a rivalry anymore because Boise State has gone to such a level, and Nevada's just not kept up with them.
This punt right here, the last two have been his best. This was going to reach the end zone. But this is a high on the season of seven punts in a ball game. So the scrimmage from the 20, 13:02 left. Boise just a short time away.
GNC this holiday season, living well means giving the gift of health. You'll save up to 50% on our widest assortment of nutritional supplements, plus holiday fitness and wellness gifts. As your leading source for health and wellness, we believe that a healthy holiday starts from within. Give good health. Live well.
Built comfortable, built strong, built right. Wrangler 5-star premium denim jeans. Wrangler, real comfortable jeans.
The hotter the hot, the colder the cold, the greater the demand, the more you need Duralast. Get the battery rated a consumer's best buy. Only at AutoZone.
I was going to steal some credit card numbers to buy that new Z52 Super Fusion telescope to try and see Uranus. Then I realized I could live like some playboy. I mean, look at me. I'm all hot. And when I'm not chilling with my ladies, I'm racing up the sweet Hawaiian coastline. Uranus is cool and all, but I want it all now. Right, Eugene?
Totally.
Rated E10 for ages 10 and up.
At our recent offsite, I picked up this juicy tidbit. SAP has software for mid-sized businesses. Trust me, it's juicy.
Taco Bell's Chicken Enchilada Grilled Stuffed Burrito. Marinated all-white meat chicken, melted cheese, and savory smothered enchilada taste. Wrapped up and grilled to go. For the taste of chicken enchiladas, think outside the bun.
Enterprise rental car for the game.
Yeah, they pick us up free.
Free pickup. They ought to be number one.
They are number one.
So if Enterprise is number one, why don't they have these?
Pick Enterprise. We'll pick you up.
ESPN2's College Football, brought to you by Remington Titanium Shavers.
So we are back now. That is ice that was man-made. Those are not the conditions here in Reno today. Now, it looked like that 2 years ago with 10 inches of snow, but not the case today. Rather brisk, but a very clear day. Good day for football, particularly for Boise fans. Has not been so great for Nevada. Good play action, and the pass comes complete to Rab. Rab is really an impressive receiver. Linda Cole, let's check back with you.
Okay, Ron, Georgia Tech already with a berth in the ACC title game. Was up 12-7 against Georgia late in the fourth when Matthew Stafford hooked up with Mohamed Basakwai for the score. Georgia then went for two and got it and was up 15-12. And Reggie Ball was just picked off, so it looks good for Georgia.
Wow. So... Boy, those rivalries. Don't be foolish and go way too far out on a limb, you know. No. It'll burn you every time. That's Rab in motion. They go with the running play to Johnson. Dr. Jerry Punch, let's check in with you again.
Well, Ron, revisiting the story today, record-setting tailback Ian Johnson was injured earlier in the year at Wyoming on September 16th. As he injured those ribs on the left side, fractured the left 7th and 8th ribs, and of course then re-injured those ribs a couple of weeks ago against San Jose on November the 11th. And he spent 5 days in a hospital in San Jose, came back last week, had not had any contact, but has been just brilliant and gutsy today, hanging on here, still playing in the fourth quarter.
Okay, back punch. Peretta comes into the ball game, number 19, but they go straight ahead with the run to Ian Johnson, and he'll have the first down.
Ian Johnson over 100 yards again. Now over 1,500 on the year, but the most with 23 touchdowns, that's leads the country. Not a Boise State record. Brock Forsey has 26, but 6.5 yards per carry is just staggering.
Yep. And the mention was made about him not making the final three as far as the top three rushers, but neither did P.J. Hill, right, the outstanding freshman up in Wisconsin, who was over 1,500 yards. Back comes to Johnson, and he slides down at the 45. And now here's today's Sharp Aquos image of the game. And as you might think, it's going to be of number 41, Ian Johnson.
Well, there was no question that he was going to play. He wanted to play last week against Utah State, just 2 days after he got out of the hospital. And the coaches wisely said no, and he continues to pound, even though they're up 31-7.
But they're going to split him out this time. He comes out on the slot to the left side, bottom of your screen. Kid really has a great body lean. Hard to really get a great shot at him for the way he carries the ball. That's Zabransky who winds up with it. I'm sure the coach is not overly pleased with that situation at this stage of the ball game.
Well, they're going to have to start calling Ian Sports Center, because every time he is on the ESPN family of networks, he is a star. We saw that game against New Mexico State earlier in the year. And you know, the amazing thing about that Oregon State game, Ron, when we talked to him, as we take a look at his folks, he said, you know, I learned a lot when I watched the tape of that game. I felt like I left another 80 or 100 yards on the field if I would have just been more patient with my cuts. Oh, sorry, Ian, you only had 240 against the Beavers.
Yeah, you notice that the Johnson family had taken those sunshades off. It's starting to get cold in this stadium. Far sideline, the ball there, a lot of to and fro. He caught that football. Jeremy Childs was being defended by Paul Pratt. Well, I can't wait to see this one on a replay.
Yeah, I think they could get. Boy, it sure looked like Childs. Watch if he gets that arm extended.
On the defense.
Well, they're calling
35.
Pratt because he never turned to make contact.
We'll take the result of the play.
In college football, you don't have to turn and find the ball, but as soon as you make contact, if you haven't turned and found the ball, they will call pass interference.
Yeah, face masking has not been around for about, what,
nope,
6-7 years
yeah,
now.
They took it out, which I like. I mean, I think at the college level, you shouldn't have face guarding, but as soon as you make contact, if you're not turned around, they are going to call it.
So that puts the ball down at the 20-yard line of Nevada. About to hit 9.5 minutes left in this final quarter. Ian Johnson gets the carry straight ahead. Maybe about four. And let's go back to Doc Punch, and you got more on Ian's hobby.
Well, Ron, you know Ian Johnson can run the football, but what else can he do? What are the skills does he have? How many future Heisman Trophy candidates do you know that can possibly crochet? Well, this young man can do it all. When he was growing up in San Dimas, California, he admired the clothing styles in New York City. And he said his mom wouldn't buy him a scarf or a toboggan. And he said, make one. So she taught him how to crochet. And now he loves to crochet. So, in fact, they won't let him sell them or even give them away anymore. But he's pretty adept at doing it.
You see how quick those hands were. And Jerry, the color. Boise orange as he gets the handoff and takes it for about 4 yards. Jonathan Amaya comes over to make the tackle. There's his mom who taught him that hobby that he has. What if he does that around the guys?
I think that's wonderful, though. She wouldn't buy it for him, so she gave him the skill to make it for himself. You know, we all want to say yes to our kids all the time, but why not say yes to teaching him something that his teammates can tease him for the rest of his life?
Oh, my. Well, for the Boise State faithful, and there are many who have journeyed here to Reno, Nevada. They got 8 minutes right now. 8 minutes left before they have made a perfect record of 12-0, winning the conference and a berth in a BCS bowl game for a non-BCS team.
Give a lot of credit to Chris Peterson. If you look down the staff that Chris Peterson had to hire when Dan Hawkins left and took and gutted the coaching staff, which happens. I mean, that's the norm when a coach leaves. Dan Hawkins took almost every assistant away from this program. And Chris Peterson, he promoted Brian Harsin from tight end coach at 29 years old to offensive coordinator. They've been great on offense. He brought in Justin Wilcox from Cal, who'd been an assistant and was a player at Oregon when Chris Peterson was there, and brought him in for a first-time defensive coordinator, a bunch of other assistants. It's been a great job.
It's amazing. When you look at Coach Peterson and his coordinators, you wonder, do any of your guys have your license yet? Are you driving? Johnson still fighting his way. He goes inside the 5-yard line. Joshua Mauga on the stop.
It's pretty interesting when you look at most consecutive wins to start. Everybody was back in leather helmet days except for Larry Coker. And again, when you look at what Chris Peterson had to do with his staff and everything else, it's amazing what he's been able to run off. He'll go to 12 today and put his team in position to go to a BCS bowl game, most likely the Fiesta.
A career high, 30 carries in a ball game. This is the 11th play of the drive, started back at the 20. He'll give it to Johnson again, and he will break through for the touchdown.
Well, that's three on the day. He's so good near the goal line, Ron. You know, you talked about his body lean.
Yeah.
He always is fighting to get to half a man. In other words, he's not running right through defenders. He looks at them as a cylinder, and he tries to get to one half over the other so they turn.
I couldn't hear, but I thought the signal, illegal substitution.
Yeah, exactly what they called.
Johnson a little tired. And Ed has talked more than once this afternoon about the fact that he has not had any contact work. And also, it's hard just to run and not go through what you've been going through. And as a result, his conditioning is not what it had been before the injury. Extra point is good. We'll take a timeout. 6:41 left in the ballgame. The new score, Boise 38 and Nevada 7. And as he scores the touchdown, his third of the day, his folks pretty happy.
Y'all ready to order?
These are his final numbers. 20 of 27, one interception, 299 yards, and a touchdown. Taylor Tharp has been throwing on the sidelines, and he'll come in and take them the final portions of this ball game as the kickoff is returnable at the 3, and it's Wilson. And D'Angelo will get it out to around the 23-yard line. Let me ask you, Ed, after a ball game like this that has so much anticipation and then so much disappointment, when Chris Ault waltzed into the locker room this afternoon, I think this is
far more important than any pregame speech that you give. You know, what's he going to say?
They've got to get ready for a bowl game. I think he's got to say, guys, you got to let this one go. Let's get over it quickly because we listen.
How do you help them heal it, though? This is a huge disappointment.
Yeah, I think you point out, though, Ron, that they really did have a nice season. You know, as disappointing as this game was, especially for Jeff Rowe, I think you've got to point to the positive of a good season to help them heal.
Play action. Rowe goes on top. He has a man there, and he underthrew it, and then the ball is dropped. Wow. Mitchell, if he throws the ball and puts some air under it, that might have been a touchdown.
And it is difficult, Ron, because they were on such a roll, had won five games in a row. This is the first time they will have lost in the past two seasons at home. But you've just got to tell these young men, keep your head up. You played hard all season. You improved. And you ran into a team, quite frankly, that felt their destiny. And Boise State, you can't say enough, Ron, about how well they play.
They don't believe they could lose now. I mean, they are. It's not cocky. It's confidence. And that is an ultimate weapon. Linda Cohn, let's check in with you as we see the pass completed.
Okay, Ron and Ed. Not to be forgotten, NCAA Division I Championship first round. Coastal Carolina, Appalachian State. Armonte Edwards with a quarterback sneak. His fifth total touchdown of the day. Appalachian State just rolling. And just a reminder, another first round game between James Madison and Youngstown State is coming up right here. 7:30 Eastern here on ESPN2. Just look at the bottom of your screen. That is our countdown clock for the big game. Ron and Ed.
Okay, thanks so much, Linda. I tell you, those are fun playoffs to watch. Done those for a number of years, and those kids, not as many scholarships, what have you. Big hole, and here we go with Hubbard. He's off to the races. They try to knock the ball away from him. Kyle Wilson does, and unable to do so, and the ball did come loose, and they're going to give it back to Boise.
What an excellent play by Kyle Wilson.
48 yards on the carry, and I said he tried to knock it away. I didn't see it come out.
He must have taken it clean from him, Ron. Wilson's just a freshman. Watch as he goes to hammer this ball. See if he just takes it clean away. Winds up, takes it right away.
That's what exactly an excellent, what it, and the knee hadn't come down.
What an excellent play by Wilson. He did a great job, too. He secured the runner from behind, which is not illegal in college football. It is. And Taylor Tharp comes in at quarterback. But, boy, what a nice job by the young man.
So four turnovers on the day by Nevada. And a timeout has been called by Nevada with 5 minutes and 10 seconds showing on the clock.
Play is being reviewed.
Boy, they're wasted one right here.
Yep. Well, I don't blame them. Might as well.
They don't have a challenge because they challenged the other
right.
one. And we were told, Doc Punch got the information after a time that that actually, when the ball was fumbled by Rowe, he thought that putting the ball on the ground, he was down, which is not the rule.
Let's see. I think you called it, Ron. Look at Hubbard's
knee. His knee's not down. See, he's got it away from him.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Ball is out. That's a good call. It should stand as it did on the field. But the situation earlier, and I'm surprised that Rowe didn't know that rule, but he thought when he put the ball down on the ground that he was down.
He told Chris Ault that I didn't fumble when he actually
had it. That's the reason his head coach challenged it.
And that's been the absolute story of this game. Nevada came into the game number one in the country at plus 15. And Chris Peterson's team has made the most of the opportunities they've been given with turnovers. Today, four turnovers for Nevada, just one for Boise State. Plus three, you're going to win a lot of ball games with that kind of turnover margin.
Taylor Tharp is in a quarterback,
review,
as we told you.
The play stands as called on the field.
Not a surprise.
First down.
Into the ball game at tailback, number 33, John Helbendahler. He is 5'11", 215, a junior out of Eagle, Idaho. And now Denton has come back in the ball game to replace Helmendahler. So I guess he'll get another shot here in just a moment. He's standing next to the coaches down on the sideline. Close to a 10-yard run by Denton here.
And in fact, they're going to say that it will be exactly 10. Jonathan Amaya making the tackle. Turnovers have been the story.
And Hubbard with two of them. Of course, the big hit on the kick return, and then Rowe putting the ball down. But what an excellent job. Once again, you can't say enough, Ron, about Kyle Wilson.
That's just
an unbelievably heads-up play. He secured the back, and again, in college football, that is not a horse collar.
That's
that
about as
a penalty.
Clean a pocket pick as you'll ever see right there. So Denton will stay in the ballgame at tailback.
Well, and they're starting to break out the Tostitos bags.
Careful now.
Yeah. And that's not because they're hungry.
John Junker is here, who is ahead of that whole game, along with all three out there in the desert country.
Well, now this is most likely. They're still in an outside chance. The Orange Bowl could take Boise State because they'll actually have an at-large choice before the Fiesta. But logic would say that because of the
physical location.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you want, and Boise State will travel well. They'll bring a ton of folks down to Glendale, Arizona. It's not in Tempe this year. Of course, Chris Peterson didn't know that. He thought the game, that's how focused he's been.
You know, we saw Ian Johnson's father on the telephone over there. He probably was not talking to a friend. He may have been called to make sure that he solidified those reservations that they have for that ball game. And let's go down to the, I was just talking about John Junker, our friend from the Fiesta Bowl. Doc Punch is with him right now.
And John, Ron Franklin was just talking about the fact that you were here and watching this football game. Now, your thoughts on watching Boise State here's performance this afternoon?
They're a great football team. They're one of two unbeaten teams in the country. Have to give Coach Peterson and their staff a lot of credit. Looks to me like they'll qualify and they belong in a BCS game.
So it looks like your matchup would be these guys probably against the winner of Nebraska and Oklahoma.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I think Boise's going to rise in the rankings. They may see some interest even from other games, but I think it's quite likely they could end up in the Valley of the Sun in the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl with the Big 12 champion.
Now, the BCS requires 17,500 tickets, but they got about 17,000 here from Boise today. I understand they're going to be standing in line for tickets in Boise, Idaho.
I think there will be a lot of excitement to be in the Valley of the Sun and be in the Fiesta Bowl and be a part of a great bowl tradition. And as one of two only unbeaten teams in the country, obviously they made a statement today, and this is a very worthy group.
Hey, John, you guys do a great job with the Fiesta Bowl. Thanks for taking a moment to stop by.
Great to be with you, Jerry.
John Junker, guys, he's watching a team that he thinks is going to give him a great football game on New Year's Day.
Well, it'll certainly garner a lot of attention. I don't think there's any doubt about that. John, just a really classy guy, has always been a good friend, and just has done a marvelous job. He and his committees out there in the Valley of the Sun. Always wish him well, but he doesn't need that because he's always way ahead of the game. They're going to keep it on the ground. In fact, they've decided let's make a little highlight tape here for Brett Denton. Now he's going to be pushed back. Blow the whistle. Let's don't get something ugly going here, guys. I mean, play is dead. Let's let that clock run on down. 2:25 left in the ballgame.
Well, when we were talking to Chris Peterson, of course, he worked under Dan Hawkins and before that, Dirk Cutter. And I said, well, Coach, you can't call Dirk Cutter if you guys get into the Fiesta and ask him about his stadium. And he said, why are they not playing it this year? That's how focused Chris Peterson. He didn't know that this year's Fiesta Bowl and then, of course, the national championship game are going to be played at the Cardinal Stadium, University of Phoenix Stadium. Is that a margarita they're going to dump on his head for the Fiesta Bowl?
Yeah, of course it is. And look at the coach is being distracted and they got him. A couple of comancheros there.
Oh, they're putting the hat on.
Draw play. Denton has 5, has 10. Hey, Denton's going to wind up with a very good afternoon on just this sequence alone. Devon Walker making the tackle.
Well, Chris Peterson talked to us earlier in the year when we did the New Mexico State game. The difficult transition it had become as the offensive coordinator to be a head coach, and he had to learn how to manage his time. He said, I couldn't just lock myself into a dark room and study film. I had to do PR and a lot more with recruits and with fundraising and things. And he said, I had to learn how to do that, and he's turning into one fine head coach.
Well, I'll tell you, after this play right here, as Denton gets the call again, he's going to be stoned and knocked down for about a 4-yard loss. If he thinks he's done some PR up until now, just hang on if he winds up going to like the Fiesta Bowl.
Well, it's a pretty good company he's stepping into. Of course, Ralph Friedgen with that amazing first year, and Larry Coker won that national championship. And Chris Peterson, first-year head coach going to the BCS, not a bad deal.
Nope. And they have worked extremely hard to get this ball club each week into shape, never looking ahead, and to take on each opponent as they have come. And they've earned it. They went up against a very stout Nevada defense today, a ball club that had several top five situations as far as takeaway categories. And right now, that's the final play of the ball game. They do not have to snap it again. Clock is about to hit 20 seconds, and it'll be Boise State in a position to get a BCS bid as a non-BCS team. And some of their faithful, not some, now several thousand, appear to be coming on the field because there are a lot of them down here. Cannon sounds as no time is showing on the clock. And I hope that everything will remain calm. And although this is the home stadium of Nevada, these guys deserve this celebration. Let's go down to the sideline. Jerry Punch with head coach Peterson.
Coach, after an emotional week, what was the key to your team's dominating performance here today?
Well, our defense. Those guys stepped up and answered every second. They were unbelievable. They played hard, and anytime these guys get challenged, they've always come through.
How would you characterize the play of Ian Johnson today?
He's a warrior. You know, the kid, I tell you, he's as tough as they come, and our O-line gives him a chance, and he's an awesome player.
What does this win, this 12-0 season, now pending BCS bowl bid, do for you and your program?
Well, I think it speaks a lot about where the program is and where it's gone and what all the people in the past that have got it to this point. I'm just happy for everybody that all the hard work we put in and finally maybe get a shot to get somewhere warm.
Hey, Coach, now the key question, do you like Tostitos?
Love them.
Hey, there's some folks behind us that want to talk to you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Guys?
Okay, Doc, thanks very much. We are going to go to a break, and then we'll come back and wrap it up. Final score, Boise 38 and Nevada 7. Boise State 12-0 on the season. We'll be right back. Ian Johnson continues to be carried off the field. In fact, let's go down to the sideline, and Doc Punch is with Ian Johnson.
I think the sign behind Ian Johnson says it all as they are celebrating the WAC championship again. Ian, congratulations. What was this day like for you to get back in a uniform having been away for 2.5 weeks?
I mean, I just want to get out here and do everything I could for my team. They said, hey, second half, we need to turn it up. I got out here, forgot about the ribs, forgot about the lung, it's nothing. These guys work hard, I'm going to work just as hard for them.
It looked like as the game went on, you got a little bit stronger. What were the ribs like early on as opposed to the fourth quarter?
The ribs felt fine. I mean, I played with broken ribs before. The only thing, it was getting back used to being in shape. I mean, taking a week off without the lungs, it hurts. But, I mean, once you get there, coaches are behind you, everyone's behind you. Say, hey, let's do it. You forget about the lungs. You don't get tired anymore.
We were questioning why you were still playing in the second half with you guys up so much. Did you want to be on the field?
I want to be in the field. I mean, there's some linemen on this team that really, really mean a lot to them this game. And I wanted to stay with them as much as I could.
What does this win and now possibly the BCS bowl bid mean to you and the players on this Bronco team?
This means everything on our pyramid is done. We've had so many goals now, and we've knocked off every single one. We've done every single thing we've been told. Our coaches told us, hey, if you listen to us, we'll get you BCS. We're there now, baby.
What will you do in the Fiesta Bowl?
What will we do? We're going to go out there, put the same intensity we always do, and go out there and win another game.
I think they're pretty excited down here, Ron.
I think they are. Jerry, be careful down there. Fans are getting a little more reckless than they have been. Final score is Boise 38 and Nevada 7. Next up on ESPN2, it's College Football Scoreboard. And for more on this game, we'll be on ESPN News in just a moment to wrap things up. This has been a presentation.